वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड आफ्टरनून और गुड इवनिंग व्हाट एवर।
यस सर, आई एम सो सॉरी। गुड इवनिंग सर, गुड इवनिंग।
गुड आफ्टरनून और अर्ली गुड इवनिंग।
या
हाय, गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू।
गुड
थैंक यू
इवनिंग,
सर, गुड इवनिंग सर।
good evening, and since we have international participants also, so the good, you know, good morning is also applicable.
Yeah, correct, correct.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Hello, Supriya.
Oh, good evening, ma'am.
Sir, is it audio and video is okay for all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Sir,
I
we're
hope
waiting.
I'm clear from this.
Yeah, we're waiting for another guest, sir. Maybe within 5 minutes, I think we will start with. It's a pleasure to have you all on the board here. This is Supriya, our student. She is from the third trimester PGDM. One of the best students for us.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
How are you, Supriya? Is pandemic is good with all of you?
Yes, ma'am. We are learning a lot of networking technology due to pandemic. We can connect through Zoom, right? So earlier it was physical. So we can learn a lot of technology into this pandemic. New change.
We wish that we can call all of you to our campus, sir. Vinod sir is having a tea. I wish that I should have served the tea to you, sir.
No, you know, this is called ET. You know, and
I know.
You and Fauji always loves it in a glass, you know. In fact, they love it in that aluminium mug. But
Kumar sir, good evening.
Good evening. Good evening, Dr. Apana.
Good evening, sir. Pleasure to have you in this evening, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, it's really great that we have such an eminent people on our board today. And it's great to have you here in the evening. It's cold and chilled in Bangalore, except Girish sir. I think three of you are not in Bangalore. So I just wanted four of you, even Supriya is not there in Bangalore. Yeah. So I have to update all of you. Our weather is really wonderful. Definitely it's not raining. It's chill. It's good. It's a wonderful weather. We are really having a good thing. So I don't know. I think all of you, all India is having the same weather. But
no,
still.
No. Gurgaon is not wonderful. It's hot and humid.
So I think all three of you, I think Kumar sir, you are there in Bangalore today, right? Tomorrow you are leaving to Delhi.
No, I'm in Gurgaon today.
Oh.
So in your part of Gurgaon, is it wonderful weather or in
40,
your part of Gurgaon?
It is 40.
40 and I think it's going to rain. The humidity is very high.
True. You are in Gurgaon, Singhji?
Yeah, I'm in DLF Phase 5, yeah, Golf Course Road.
Good. As long as you are closer to the golf course, I mean, the weather should not, hassle you.
Vinod sir is a stringent golf player. So that's I think he got all the weather where the golf place it is.
Quite near Dr. Kumar's campus, in fact, my home. I think maybe around 2 kilometers, or even less than that.
There is one very good joke, you know, if we are not delaying the program.
Sir, please.
Yeah. You know, some people are so diehard golfers that there was, a guy who was playing and he requested everybody that, we must, pause for 5 minutes. So the other people in the four ball, they asked, he says, sir, anything urgent? So they saw, a coffin going. So he put his club, down on the green and he bowed to the departed soul. So the other four ball members said, okay, sir, we must appreciate, your dedication and zeal to the departed soul. So the guy said, this is the least I can do to my wife who just passed away.
Oh my God.
There are some such diehard golfers that, come what may, they will be there on the course.
Correct.
In fact, Dr. Vinod Ji,
Yes,
often going, often going is a good sign.
Yeah, it is good sign.
Yeah, both. And coffin going and the person going in that.
Definitely, sir. Military people, coffins don't, it doesn't make you scared about it. But maybe we are teachers here, so definitely we should think about it. Sir, should we start the program now?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Supriya, please take ahead.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, one and all. I would, with pleasure, I would welcome you all to another panel discussion by GIBA, Spreading of Light and Knowledge, and on post-COVID business strategies, Unlock 2.0. And I would like to introduce the panelists. Speaker one for the day would be Anta Preet Singh. He's a director, Digital Learning ISB Hyderabad, India. Anta Preet is a very well-known thought leader, speaker, writer, mentor, and researcher in the field of digital transformation, digital HR, strategic entrepreneurship, future skills, and human capital development is his field. Anta Preet has been a global citizen with 35 years of association with global technology companies. He held various leadership positions in Fitchesi, Tell Labs, Lucent A&T, Alcatel-Lucent, and Reliance Jio. He was Asia-Pacific head for Alcatel-Lucent University, which has 24 campuses in APAC and presence in 117 countries globally. He's also associated with Indian Schools of Business, a world-class B-school. Anta Preet is a visiting faculty with Sevier Premier B-schools and also providing consulting services in digital transformation to industry, including various startups. He's currently researching in digital transformation space, including man-machine collaboration and using AI to develop our country's capital and take our digital economy to new heights. We are glad to have you here on the panel. Thank you so much. And the keynote speaker for the day would be Dr. DNS Kumar, Vice Chancellor, Sushant Singh University. Dr. Kumar possesses 33 years of rich experience in different roles and responsibilities. Dr. Kumar has taken several initiatives in opening new paths, conducting academia to the world ahead. He was doctorate from Karnataka University. Dr. Kumar is a master in commerce, has been many stars onto his shoulder. A certified master analyst in financial forensics, Dr. Kumar has specialized in valuation of companies, bankruptcy, liquidation, and reorganization. Dr. Kumar has worked closely with industry and academia, which has given an insight in both professional spheres. He focused upon building a bridge between academia and the industry, and he's taken many initiatives in this aspect. And we are glad to have you here, sir. A hearty welcome to you, sir. Another keynote speaker for the day would be Mr. Girish Kausgi, MD CEO of Canfin Homes Limited. Girish is a banking professional with 24 plus years of experience. Mr. Girish has an extensive experience of managing assets and liabilities and has gained expertise in mortgage, retail lending, SME and agri businesses. And as a part of his career so far, he was worked with HDFC, ICIC, IDFC and Tata Capital. He has an expertise in dealing with variety of loan products like home business, loans, business loans, LAP, personal loans, and rural products, etc. He was featured in Economic Times Coffee Table Book and was awarded Most Promising Business Leader of Asia by Economic Times Asia Business Conclave. During his tenure, Canfin Homes was awarded for the best brand of brand by Economic Times. We are glad to have you here, sir, on the panel. Thank you so much. And the keynote speaker for the day would be Brigadier Vinod Datta, sir. Vinod, sir, is a warrior and logistician, a former secretary of Defense Crisis Management Group. He has overseen operations in a number of disaster crisis situations at national and international level. He has handled supply chain logistics in Kargil war with excellence. Some of important operations dealt in Kashmir floods, Nepal earthquake, Chennai floods, and Kutangal fire. He conceptualized the first ever Indo-USH-AADR exercise with international observer. Presently, Brigadier is a senior advisor in PNB, involved in disaster strategy and recovery. He has deep understanding of business process, stakeholders, and interdependencies. I think this is very short to give a note about you, sir. It's really pleasure and humble to speak about you. And we are very glad to have you on the panel. Hearty welcome to you, sir.
Thank you very much.
And the moderator for the day would be Dr. K. Aparna Rao, director of GIBS Bangalore. Aparna ma'am is playing a very key role in formulation, implementation of different educational strategies that will enhance the value and reputation of the institution. She owns a doctorate in philosophy from Coimbatore University, and she's a honoree of South India Women's Achiever Award 2020. And she's a laureate of Distinguished Women's Achiever Award 2020. And she's also a recipient of National Women's Leadership. And she has a lot of association with many national, international associations. And she's an official research guide for PhD and management discipline. And we are glad to have you as a director, ma'am. And we are glad to have you as a moderator for the day.
Thank you, Supriya. It was such a great welcome, and it's very nice to have all of you on the board, sir. It's our privilege to have you. To start with, the show goes into this particular topic, which we go with. The pandemic will fundamentally reshape how we do business from now on. Even if lockdowns end soon and the virus is staunchly suppressed, never to return, its effect will linger. Now that the whole world has experienced the VUCA that only emerging markets used to face, it can never again be treated as an abstract. Everyone knows that the shattering impact of COVID-19 has brought on the business crisis without precedent. In recent memory, the basic purpose of business strategy is to steer companies towards sustainable growth, sustainable sources of growth and the profit. It is my pleasure, and I express my profound gratitude to all the eminent speakers for calibrating their time and accede our invitation. Sir, it's our pleasure to have you all here, sir. Not wasting much of the time, there are 230 participants who's waiting for this steering of the knowledge, and they will definitely not like me talking more. And when I'm having the starlets over here in front of me, sir, let's go for the panel discussion. I open up the panel discussion now. I'm Dr. Aparna, director GIBS B School, who will be acting as a moderator for you. And hope we'll all take a very healthy and a very nice discussion today in this evening. I open up the panel discussion. The topic is post-COVID-19 business strategies, unlock 2.0. So to start with it, so I just wanted to crop up my first question to all the panelists here. What position can the economy attain after the pandemic? Sir, it is an open question for all of you. It is generalized question. To start with, Dr. Kumar, can I go with you for this question, sir?
Dr. Aparna, thank you for the opportunity.
Yes, sir.
And my learned colleagues and participants. I say colleagues to my panelists because it's going to be a learning exercise. Well, pandemic, many of us talk about it has hit the economy. All sectors of the economy for that matter. But if we introspect ourselves, is it not it gave an opportunity for us to identify the hidden talents that we had? Many a time, we were doing our day in and out activities, or maybe corporate activities where we are engaged in, or educational activities where we are engaged in. And our focus is to be all the time how to slice the pie. We never is to give any thought in terms of how to grow the pie. But this pandemic, in true sense, not only personally, but also as a head of the institution and with a few corporates with whom I'm directly dealing, have created wonders for themselves. There's a true disruption which has happened not only to the minds, but also to the activities. So that way, pandemic has given us a good lessons It has built us it has built us skills. I mean, multi skills, and way forward, it is going to be a very good disruptive economic activity. That is what I see. That's my opening remark.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much for this insight, sir. Dr. Vinod, you are such a great speaker. I have listened to your videos and all that. And an everyday TV show, you will be having it. You have seen it into a broader perspective. So what is your view into this?
Good evening, Dr. Aparna. And I must thank GIBS and the esteemed faculty for giving me this opportunity to speak to you and to the brilliant students you have. And I have been following the GIBS activities and the curriculum.
Pleasure.
It is it has always been an immersive learning as far as these panels are concerned.
Yes, sir.
Taking the point further from what Dr. Kumar had said, I will take you back in backdrop. There people say that not all storms come to disrupt your way. There are some storms which also clear your path.
Yeah.
And, a lot of people are telling that 2020 is the worst year, 2021 is even, bad. But if you go back in history, agar aap tareekh mein jaye, 536 AD was the worst year. And where, for a considerable time, for months together, for years together, there were Icelandic volcanoes. The severest winter in 2,300 years, there were, nothing to eat in China, West Asia, and many other countries. And that lasted for quite some time. And this has been recorded by Michael McCorkick, who is a Harvard historian. So the impact of any disaster or crisis-like situation always impacts on the economy. And the economy also got hit, and the economy could only come up by 640 AD. So this pandemic has also plunged the entire world in contraction. It has, if you see, there has been a slump of 23.9% in the GDP. And if you see that India has been losing $6 billion worth business almost every day, because even if there is a, we have been hearing about Bharat Band and various other parties which call, every Bharat Band costs you 20,000 crore rupees.
True, sir, true. Yeah.
So that is the kind of impact it has on economy. And it has always, if you go back in history, if you see Black Death, when it had hit Europe, it resulted in fall of Roman Empire. So the economic impact, because economy, society, and psychology are three subjects which are so intertwined that they have impact. And more so in today's global, in fact, I will use the word which our Honorable Prime Minister uses, in the global world, and what Dr. Aparna had already brought out, in this VUCA world. Now there is so much of interdependencies.
Yeah.
When the last pandemic had taken place in 1918, people were not aware. The communications were not there. 100 million people had expired.
Yes, sir.
So the impact is always there. So the pandemics will have economic impact, and they are going to affect the economy, substantial manner. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Since sir has started about the economy, and that's the basic thing where the world looking to, Mr. Kosicki, what do you talk about this? What is your views into this?
Good evening, Dr. Aparna, and all the panelists, entire team of GIBS, and all the viewers. A very good evening to all of you.
Yes.
This pandemic, COVID-19, is one of its kind, probably in a century. Now, no doubt it impacted the economy. There were loss of lives. When we talk about, it impacted the economy, we always talk about growth. When we talk about growth of the economy year on year, it's always in comparison with few other countries. Now, this pandemic impacted almost all the countries, barring, a few.
Whole world. Yes, sir.
Yeah, it impacted the whole world. And therefore, maybe you will see a little slowness in the progress of each of the countries with respect to economic development, because we always talk about growth only in comparison with other countries. Since this impacted everyone, and obviously, lives are more important than livelihood. And yes, definitely there is impact on the economy, but I don't think so that we need to really worry about, but for worrying about lives and how quickly we can get them back to normalcy with increased spend on healthcare, right? Now, definitely, yes, we saw contraction in GDP in quarter one to the extent of 24%, and Q2 was about 7.5%. Definitely, yes. But if you look at quarter four, it was 1.6%. So it takes time, but definitely it took time much shorter than what we all thought about. In last year, I think most of the industries in our country lost about 5.5 to 6 months, but the recovery by the corporate world in quarter three was phenomenal, and quarter four was even better than quarter three.
Yeah.
Yes, it impacted the economy, but I think the recovery was pretty fast. If you look at second wave, in fact, today I just saw IIP numbers of April. I know it is compared to the small base. It was pretty good. It was almost about 31.2%. Even if you have to look at quarter four, it was highest in last many quarters. So all I'm saying is that, yes, it impacted the economy. Recovery is pretty fast. What happened during this? You saw that investments went up.
Yeah. Right? Yes, sir.
It maybe, the progress got slightly deferred. There was an impact. I would, obviously consider impact in terms of livelihoods and, to a certain extent, loss of life. But nothing beyond that, because we can always make it up. And in wave two, I'm sure the recovery is going to be much faster, because the curve, pandemic curve, wave two is much shorter. In about 70 to 75 days, we've seen, almost the pandemic curve coming down to as low as maybe less than 1 lakh.
I think even we are prepared for the second pandemic, right, sir?
I think we have learning of first wave.
Yeah. And
probably even though we didn't anticipate when it hit us, we were not prepared actually. But when it hit us, we were able to recover it fast because we had experience of wave one.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Mr. Singh, you belong to the digital world. You belong to the world which is coming up, which is for tomorrow. So what is your views into it?
So there's a power outage.
No problem, sir. No problem. You're very good. Seconds, yes, yes.
30 seconds. This will. So I am going to talk about growth and 34% CAGR. You are going to tell me, are you off your mind? COVID-induced digital transformation of Indian economy. Even before pandemic, in 2018, Ministry of IT and Electronics, in collaboration with McKinsey, had made a blueprint for India's digital economy with a dream of achieving economic output of $1 trillion by 2025. And that the Minister of Electronics and IT did table that report, the Rajya Sabha, in 2018. And 2019 and 2020 beginning, we had a pandemic. Currently, we are at $250 billion as far as digital economy is concerned. And the digital economy is growing at a compounded annual growth rate of 34%. And this will become 25% of India's economy by 2025. And I have been conducting pan-India these workshops, seminars for youth in various states. By 2030, the share of digital economy in overall economy will be 40%. So 40-60, it's almost equal, 50-50, or 40-60.
Yeah.
So the point I'm making is, and I'll be talking more about key data pointers and future skills and new age jobs. During pandemic, first wave and second wave, we have had a phenomenal growth of digital economy.
Yeah.
it has been a COVID-induced transformation of Indian economy. Some of the statistics, like from 5 crore e-commerce users, we've grown today to 20 crore. It's a 4x in just 5 years. And in next 5 years, from 20, we are going to go to 50 crore plus e-commerce users. This is almost like two United States of America's as our e-commerce users. So this is the magnitude. And I'm going to talk about some more figures. Some of these are startling. I mean, one can say, oh my God, this is the level of growth we've been going through. And before I conclude my argument, I say that the proactive steps by the government, today we have high-speed networks. I mean, just imagine if we were not developed in telecom, data, video, what would have happened? Even though the businesses were locked, the campuses were locked, we were able to move forward. And that has been thanks to the world-class digital infrastructure the country is having, the world-class brain power country is having, no match to the brain power India has. Because of that, we are growing and we are at 250 billion. We are 4x growth in next 4 years to become a $1 trillion. And what I am doing as my part of my PhD in IIM Indore, I am doing a lot of research in these areas, including India's digital economy. So I'll talk more about this. I mean,
thank you.
Is something very close to my heart.
Yes, and, sir. That's really great. That's what world is looking forward now, the digital world.
Yes.
So the next question, I'll take it to Dr. Datta. Like we talk about onto the larger extent after the things like, is India ready to overcome the economic crisis? If you feel so, is economic crisis is started and after the post-pandemic?
Yes, Dr. Aparna, India, you see, Indian economy, if you see, is quite a resilient economy. And the next century belongs to us. And, you know, I will, in fact, it belongs to people of Supriya's generation, because they are the destiny designers, and there are a fair amount of students who are there, because ye Bharat ke bhagya vidata hain, destiny designers. And we have a very compelling story, and the world knows about it. And if you see, the 60% of GDP, it comes from services. Though we have been talking about population, yes, population control is a must, but the focal point of any industry, any economy is consumer centric. See, Winston Churchill once had said that consumer is such an important person that the person should talk to him in such a manner that he feels that he's the emperor of the world.
Yeah, that's true, no, sir.
Yeah, it is. So that's very, very important. And India has taken, stand. We have seen a recession of say about 10.6-7%. But yes, we will bounce back. And by 2022, India is going to get back to the rails. Primarily, I attribute it to the GDP sector, which is there. Second thing is the Atmanirbhar, you know, Bharat, which we have started. So the government is really pushing this project, and the people are, and what, Mr. Singh had already said, that we have one of the best, brilliant people. We have very hardworking people. And our population, our people, our intelligentsia, our academia is very, very least demanding.
Yes.
Because we can produce things in a jiffy.
Totally agree.
Then
totally
the
agree.
Reduce of import is going to, the government has already started working on it.
Yeah.
That the reduction on import and saving the foreign exchange is going to give a push up to the economy. Then the energy sector and coal mining sector, the agro sector. Unfortunately, we have been listening in we have been always mugging up ever since we were students that India is an agricultural country. Bharat ek krishi pradhan desh hai, jiski 80% abadi gaon mein rehti hai. You see, the urbanization which has taken place and the challenges which we have. You see, the challenges what India has, nobody has. We add 2 crore people every year. And the population of Australia is 2.46 crores. So if any nation has to support a nation every year, whatever progress you register, whatever development you show to people, it will not be visible. There will not be tangible results. But yes, notwithstanding that, the economy is coming up and it is looking up. Then the power sector. And the biggest factor which I consider is because again, Winston Churchill had said, let no opportunity go as waste, or let no crisis go as waste.
Yeah.
Because we are riding on this demographic tiger and the million of consumer base. Because why China and such economies are looking at India is because we have the consumer, have the consumer base. And when we have millions of consumers, we also have millions of producers. So they are going to take the country ahead. And lastly, between our mistakes of yesterday and the hope of tomorrow, there is a wonderful opportunity called today. So we
don't
must...
you think this gap is big, sir? Yesterday
it is
and
big.
Tomorrow?
You see, Dr. Aparna, very rightly you brought out, you flagged this issue. I'll just take 30 seconds because
sir.
I don't want to eat into others' time also. Yeah. A guy was always asked, he's a man of few words, but the problem is he keeps on repeating them. So what I want to tell you is that the economy, now people have identified, we have always been, reactive. We have never been, proactive.
Yes.
Like the second wave, it took everybody by surprise. And there is enough material on internet. Leave aside the think tanks, leave aside the intelligentsia, jo zehni log hain, but nobody thought that it will come.
Yeah.
There are people, there is one district magistrate in Nandurbar. He had visualized that, yes, the oxygen is going to be a critical thing. He had planted those plants, he manufactured oxygen, and people from Karnataka, people from neighboring states are coming to this neighboring district and getting treated. So what we require is strategic vision. And of course, now, with a jolt, people have started looking up. And I'm sure the economy is going to bounce back. And as they say, the next century belongs to India. And it belongs to people like, Supriya and many other youngsters and millennials.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. It was so wonderful to have your insights into this. Mr. Singh, I just wanted to ask this question to you. What are the industries which can see a promising growth in this pandemic? As we all know that the digital part of it, the industry is, even if you take from the internet to anything, what you look for, promising industries?
Yeah, so Brigadier Dutta has spoken up so nicely about various industry sectors, and Professor Kumar and Mr. Girish will also be talking about. Let me give a sense about digital economy. What kind of sectors, what kind of jobs for youth? 60 to 65 million new age jobs, which is 6 to 6.5 crore new age jobs by 2025 will be supported by digital economy. And during my master classes, during my sessions, I always say every business is a digital business. People say, how? I mean, every business is not a digital business. I give a very simple example. Today, if you see worldwide, take top 6 companies by way of market capitalization. You have top 5 companies, Apple, Microsoft, Google, Amazon, Facebook, which are at the top 5 in terms of market capitalization. And 6th is a Saudi Aramco, which is a brick and mortar. So these 5 are producing digital solutions for whom? For rest of the world. They are consuming, which means every company, every sector, every institution is a digital, and digital is now no longer a kind of an option. And some of the, if you specifically ask me, some of the sectors I did identify, healthcare and e-healthcare and healthcare with the digitalization and digitization of the sector, this is going to be very, very important sector of the industry, future skilling and education. We had NEP 20, the new National Education Policy 2020 announced, which focuses on the skills which our economy requires by 2025, those 60, 65 million new age jobs require new age skills. And I go to many universities, I go to IIMs, I go to various premier B schools. Honestly, I don't see that happening to that level.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Otherwise, how will we create those 60, 65 million youngsters who can take up those jobs? Since you've asked me specifically, some of the other sectors would be automobiles.
Yeah.
There is now pandemic has changed rules of the game. I would like to own my own vehicle. And I would like to be safe. I don't know. This pandemic, next pandemic, I mean, it has just turned around. And lastly, the blended education. I mean, there are so many. We can debate for hours. I was there in one of the, I think, month earlier where there were 3-4 vice chancellors. And one of the esteemed vice chancellor, he said that we've now, whatever we've learned during pandemic, now as we open up campuses, why should we, for some of the courses, why should we, or some of the degrees, why should students migrate from small towns and villages to metros and take accommodation or pay hostel fee and lot of expenses? Why can't we teach them digitally? But they can come to campus. They can come to campus once in 3 months for 10 days or something like that. So there is a lot of innovation which is going to happen. There is a lot of demand, as Brigadier Dutta was mentioning, which is going to get generated. But unless you have those digital interfaces, I mean, you don't have to be a digital company in terms of inventing those business digital solutions or digital technologies. But you can leverage, as we say, man-machine collaboration.
Yes, sir.
Even we talk of selective de-skilling.
Yeah.
And I'll stop here, otherwise I'm not going to end.
No, sir. Yeah. Digital part of it, when you talk, it is, I know it is a big ocean it goes with, of course, every subject. So but that is the subject, that is the subject we are focusing on tomorrow now. That is where we go with.
So to conclude these 60, 65 million new age jobs, and there are a lot of areas, robotic process automation, blockchain, cyber security, we have Internet of Things, a lot many areas.
So more in other industries, like if you could able to take even the furniture, even the workspaces, even everywhere, the industry is totally changing.
In fact, I'll talk more as I get more time. I think
sure, sir.
Let's pass it on to the next one.
Sure, definitely. It was really like, as I say, it's like a well, like you're going in and the subject is completely taking us into it. Sir, I'll go to the next question. There are increasing indications that the world will look different after the crisis and the globalization will be questioned in many years. The COVID-19 crisis would make a turning point. In this context, Mr. Kausiki, the question which I'm asking you is, what can be the possible paradigm shift in consumer behavior post-COVID, if you take for?
Actually, we are seeing the shift happening, as Mr. Singh told a few years back. You know, when we say that, you know, everything is a digital business, I'm sure there'll be very few takers. But today, I think this pandemic has made us believe that it is a reality. Now, there are two things here. One is the mindset. Let's say if I want to buy an apparel or a furniture, now, how will I buy online without seeing the furniture? How will I buy an apparel? Now, that is the mindset part. Now, I think now that is no more after pandemic. It was not there a few years back. It was there. Now you can see a lot of online business in last 1 year post-pandemic, wave one. Now, if you look at credit, the most difficult part of digitization is credit. When I talk about credit, you know, I talk about various consumer loans, like it could be personal loan, it could be business loans, it could be small micro enterprise loan or a mortgage loan, right? Now today we've reached to such an extent, it was not there earlier. It was there since last 5 to 7 years. Adoption was a challenge. So we had solutions, adoption was a challenge, and now we are seeing the adoption. So technically, I can pull a, I can pull a bureau string on customer. I can give a pre-approved. I can just send it, through electronic mode, make him accept, and probably I can get e-NACH and I can disburse. So without customer having to move from his or her house, I can sanction and I can disburse credit to customer's account now. Yes. I think the adoption is the shift what we are seeing now during this pandemic, which was very low earlier. Starting from Government of India, the regulator, RBI, NHB, all the stakeholders, they've been trying to push digitization because of so many reasons. One, the company can save cost because brick and mortar is not required. A, B, it's going to be much cost effective. And number three, it will be much faster as a process to the customer as well as to the corporates. Now, this pandemic has seen that shift. So the shift in terms of adoption, we've seen it already. Now, we had never heard of, too many online classes. Today, I think whole of last year was online. I have two, kids. They were in Bangalore and attending classes online, right? One was supposed to be in Pune and the other one in Bombay. So they're here since last 1 year, right? So it's not just education, it's also credit. Even meetings, what we're doing now is online, right? So I think physical meeting is not required, always required. And the biggest mindset is that we can do at least most of the work other than software and IT years from home, which we thought 2 years back, it was not possible. Even today, there are certain legs, which requires customer interface in terms of physical meetings. Otherwise, I think most of the processes have been adapted to align to the need, and that need is because of this pandemic. Now, during this time, what we have seen is that there has been a lifestyle change.
Yeah.
There is a change in spending habit.
Yeah.
You see, there has been a lot of savings. So if you look at the savings was highest during this pandemic.
Oh, really, sir?
Yeah. Actually, if I have to talk about quarter four was the highest in last 26 quarters.
Okay.
Right. Now, there's a lot of attention given to health, and therefore, there is a lot of spend on healthcare. We see a lot of people now trying to cover health and life, which has increased in last few quarters.
Yeah.
So, there has been a lot of change in customer behavior, largely because of pandemic. To a certain extent, it could be an adoption issue. Today, we have so many fintechs, who would integrate, who would collaborate with larger companies. This could be in any field. It could be in software, it could be in pharma, it could be in financial services, be it bank, NBFC, or a housing finance company, any field. Yeah. As Mr. Singh rightly said, there is an opportunity to digitize literally anything and everything, other than what genuinely requires the customer interface. So we've seen phenomenal change, and this would in a way help us to grow much faster in future because of this change.
Great, sir. Great. It's such an insight. It's a vast subject, as again, finance, banking, money, it is definitely always into the numbers. So the next question, maybe the question from Supriya also, the youngsters is looking forward for such type of the things. I would ask Dr. Kumar, who else can answer this more better than him? What could be the future of startups in India? Like many of the students, more than the corporates, more than the jobs, they're now looking forward for the startups. What could be the sustainability business model according to you, sir?
Well, when I read your question on my WhatsApp,
yes, sir.
I remembered a friend of mine whom I admire a lot, who is none other than Rajiv Bajaj.
Okay.
When he wanted to close his Bajaj scooter business, having 3,000 employees at Pune, he was in dilemma as to how to convince his father, Rahul Bajaj. That time, Rahul Bajaj was the member of Rajya Sabha. I will not give statistics. I will give some examples.
Yes,
because
sir.
My other panelists are giving so much of statistics. Then Rahul's friend was a good friend of Raji. Then he asked him, "Uncle, tell me, how should I convince my father? Because this business is not going to continue in the long run, the scooter business." He said, "Rajiv, are you convinced?" "Yes, I'm very much convinced." "Why, you have to ask your father. Put the notice on the notice board that you are going to send out all the 3,000 employees. And the reason you know why you are doing that, the skill sets are not there with these people."
Yes.
So then Rajiv did it. And 1 or 2 days, employees made a noise. But he had put a notice in such a way, balance of your service, whatever you have, the entire salary will be paid to you. Mm-hmm. You can leave the company. He sent out all those people, brought in new blood and new talent with a skill set which is required for the future of a business. And he started a vehicle business. And today, 47% of the production they export. So that is, we have to reinvest in the business. Reinvest in terms of decision making also. Reinvest
also in the skill sets, as you said. Yes, sir.
At the same time, since the question is for startups, you know, they require some support from the government also. And yes, government is very active. It, rather, it is a proactive these days. When I used to do a consulting assignment for small and medium-sized industries, I'll take one example for foundry industries. I did a lot of work for them.
Okay.
So these people, although they were from Suratkal Engineering Colleges, IIT Madras and all that, they had not seen a bigger market than the region. Forget the export and all that. So Government of India had come out with an icon on their website, DGTD, Director General Trade and Development. If you click on that icon and if you put 4 or 8 digit excise code number, the entire world, what is the market available for casting is available.
Yeah.
So we need to reinvest for digitization also. Support of the government also is required. If all that happens, the handholding activity from all the stakeholders of the business, the future for the startups is very bright. I'll give you another example.
Yes,
when I was teaching MBA students, I had a student, his name was Basavaraj, and we used to call him as a Basu. And his father was a principal of a degree college. And I asked him, "Basu, what are you going to do after you are a PGDM?" "Sir, I'm going to start a small business of my own." "No, man, your father is a principal and you want to do a business." "Yes, sir, I come from a belt wherein a lot of chilies are grown." "So chilies are grown, what are you going to do?" "I will make chili powder and I will start exporting." And he's one of the leading exporters after 17 years of business in the chili industry. It is not that only few sectors only wherein you can get a good, bright future. You have to make it.
Yes.
And as I say, reinvestment, relearning, unlearning, I would request all the participants and also my colleagues on the panel, please go through a YouTube video of Rajiv Bajaj. The name is, "If I Knew Then What I Know Now." Then every one of us will be very much interested in investing in learning. And that will build the sustainability also. But when you say sustainability of the business, we have to explore the new market.
Yeah.
We have to diversify. We are into education and we remain only into education. Right, mass education, the era is gone with NEP. It's going to be the class education. Right, BCom, MBA, PGDM, everywhere across the country, same. We are creating a band company.
Yeah.
But in the market, band players are not required. People with new skill sets are required. So
yes,
therefore,
sir,
not only focusing on the current market where you are addressing your product, to sustain, you have to explore, you have to create a new product. Let's take the example of Coca-Cola and Pepsi. In 2000s, when I did my PhD on the soft drink industry, that time only 250 and 350 ml bottles were there.
Mm.
They created a new market.
Yes.
Where it is available for 100 ml also, 200 ml also, 1 liter also, 1.5 liter also, 2.5 liters.
Yes.
So, the people who were not able to afford the price of your 250 ml to 350 ml. Now, if the product is available for 100 ml, you have created a new market. So that way, you have to, you know, you have to sustain by, you know, reinvesting. And I say reinvestment, not only in terms of knowledge, but also investment in the product development also.
Yes.
Also, let's take the example of Maruti, Maruti 800. If you take Maruti example, Maruti 800 15 years back and today's Maruti 800, of course, today you don't find much of Maruti 800.
Maruti.
A lot of values they have added.
Yes.
And those values, people want it. So it has to be value driven. Value is not in terms of money only. Value is the satisfaction which the people derive out of it.
Yes, so, sir.
We can sustain the business. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It's such a powerful answer. I think, Supriya, I think you have got some insights to go with your startup. Okay. So yes, this is a young world who's looking for the startups than the jobs. But that's what Dr. Kumar has rightly said, that skill sets is more important than anything else. Sir, I move on to my next question. Brigadier Datta, it's for you. Like, we could see the livelihoods of millions of people got affected, especially the people in bottom of the pyramid. Can brain gain create more opportunities? What role government can play in doing this more effectively in this regard? My question is, can technology help the farmers to market their product in post-pandemic? Is it recommended strategy for the business? Sir, what do you say about this?
Dr. Panna, you are a very successful academician. You would have been a very good cricketer also, because the googlies and the yorkers which you are throwing, this question is like Jai Jawan, Jai Kisan. But you see, a soldier is always prepared, and I'll take on this question.
Yes, sir.
You see, we are a agro-based economy. We have been harping on, you know, a lot of issues which are agro-based. A lot of people, in fact, a lot of governments have gone to the corridors of power, riding on the shoulders of the farmers. But unfortunately, you know, we have been talking a lot of strategies and this. And in this question, I'm going to focus mainly on where the nation has lacked, where the nation has neglected the farmers, where the nation has neglected the agro industry. The growth in agro industry is to the tune of, you know, something ranging between 3.5 to 4%. And if you see the inflation rate, and I'm not going to quote, you know, these statistics, because we have had too much of stats. The inflation rate is 5+. So if this sector, and in this pandemic, it is only the supply chains and the farmer which kept this nation, you know, fully fed, fully fit, and fighting fit.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, you see, what happens is we have been doing a lot of, you know, we have been, we start with a bang and end with a whimper. There was transport industry which was lying idle. There were farmers who were ready to produce, who were ready to, you know, sell their product, but the products never reached the consumer.
Yes.
The government could have utilized those, you know, transporters. They could have given them the price which they deserve. They were people, they were farmers who were throwing their produce on ground because they did not have money, or there was nobody to pick it up. So what my earnest request is that what we require, like, you know, I'll give you a difference between an industrialist and a businessman. What is the difference between an industrialist and a businessman? A businessman is profit-centric. Hmm. He's only hovering around profit. Profit is not a bad word. Profiteering is.
Yes, yes.
The difference between a businessman and industrialist is that industrialists, they create wealth. So my request is that there should be a shift. Like if you take Ratan Tata, if you take Azim Premji and many more who are industrialists. I have not taken the name of some big wigs whom I consider, and these are my personal views, that they are businessmen. So they should focus on agro-based industries. It is the farmer who requires the attention of the government. I will also take, you know, since we have, you know, two girls also or ladies sitting in the panel, excuse me, we have a large potential of, you know, contribution. If you see Lajjat Papad, aapne dekha hoga.
Yeah.
That lady, she started with just 85 rupees. Now she has a turnover of crores. It is self-empowerment. If you see 20% of business is owned by women. And as per Bain and Company report, the atmosphere or the environment in India is conducive for agro-based industries. Though Kharif and various other. I recall very vividly, you see, my father talking about, you know, famine. After 1965 war, there was a, you know, such a famine in India that every Monday people used to fast.
Yeah.
And people from, you know, good families used to fast so that poor can get at least one meal a day. And that is a time when America gave those, you know, red wheat, which was called PL480.
Yes.
So
yes, sir.
From, you know, a food deficit nation, we are a food surplus. We have been, you know, exporting a lot of food. There has been increase of 13%, you know, in Kharif crop. Today, the problem is that there is a tremendous or a phenomenal amount of food or the food grain which is wasted on the field to the mandis or to the end consumer. So it is high time that the government should address this issue. You see, if you see the workforce, the substantial workforce, you know, the ladies are owning 2% of the land in India. So it is high time that the government should address this issue, and we must, you know, empower this sector. We have
so
been,
do you think the brain gain is happening, sir? Is this pandemic at least made the government to think about this?
No, no. You see, the problem, Dr. Aparna, in India is ki hamare yahan jo bhi cheez hoti hai, uska keval zikr aur fikr hota hai.
Yes.
Once this pandemic is over, everything will be totally, you know, brushed aside. So we I told you, we start with a, you know, bang and end with a whimper. So what is required is that in right earnest, you see, if you see urbanization, when we got independence, 1947, it was 16%. Today in 2021, we have 40%, you know, urbanization we have. So almost half of India is urbanized. The agricultural land is shrinking. The food requirement is increasing. So it is high time that we must strengthen this sector. And this is the substantial, or this is the backbone of our economy, which is going,
yes,
to sustain.
Yeah. And I think with this, like the bottom of the pyramid, which we are talking where we shouldn't, but we are putting the farmers there, we'll get that type of thinking, as Dr. Datta is telling, that would help the people to grow and maybe the economy, and the government should think about this. Sir, to just take forward with the same thought, Dr. Kumar, what would be the possible reforms post-pandemic in the education industry? If I don't ask this question to you, sir, I don't think that I can answer anything. It's a large chunk of the world is the student fraternity, right? So the main economy, whatever we talk, the biggest chunk it is the students. It's for the future. So what do you think in this?
Well, Dr. Aparna, it is a very pertinent, you know, the statement you have made. I will not say it is a question.
Yeah.
One thing which is going to happen in a very short span of time is acquisition of educational institutions by corporates. Or educational institutions will come forward and sell their educational institution because they cannot, and they have not invested the kind of investment which is required for creating a new knowledge. Whereas corporate wants the new knowledge, they will acquire and they will train the students. That is number one. Number two, a trend has already emerged and it has started in a slow manner. And it will pick up, that is shared ownership.
Okay.
If educational institutions want the brightest of the bright employees that they have at the helm of the APES, they have to make them a partner. Otherwise, suppose take the example of Dr. Kumar only. Why should I put my all knowledge, ability and all for a small amount of salary that I get?
Yes.
Right? I want to be part of the ownership process. I am just taking mine as an example. Then third thing which is going to happen is educational institutions, having identified the talent pool in their educational institution, may invest on the employees to incubate the ideas.
Yeah.
That is the third one. The very much which is required, and good institutions are going to emerge with their own reforms. They will not wait for government reforms. That is investment in technology. Then at the same time, industry-driven educational ecosystem is going to emerge.
Yeah.
Wherein as edutech companies are coming, right? These edutech companies are not highly educated people in the field of subjects, courses and all. But they are reaching to the talented professors.
Yes.
And they are asking them to build such courses which are not just online courses, which are applied courses.
Yes, sir. Then
a solution can be found by learning such courses. And at the same time, I can talk on this so much, but in the higher education scenario, continuing professional education is going to be mandatory in due course of time.
Yeah.
Unlike in Western countries, if you want to retain your professional certification, every year you have to do so many number of professional courses.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, that has not come into the higher education. Therefore, what I had taught last year, last year, 5 years back, same thing I teach.
Yes, therefore, that is what is happening
therefore,
now.
Therefore, Mr. Singh was rightly mentioning, he visiting several campuses, he's not able to see any change.
Yes, that is what.
Whether NEP comes or another 10 NEP comes, unless and until we start individually getting disrupted and individually start getting reformed ourselves, we will not be able to bring any reforms in higher education. But
yes,
as I mentioned, all these things are going to happen.
Very rightly said, sir. Maybe being an educationist, I could connect myself so much to Dr. Kumar's talking to it. And any colleges are doing their corporate and campus talks and finishing school style of, bringing out the students out. Yes,
sir. My own university, we have 30 programs.
Yeah.
Right. In a span of 1 year, 18 program I have tied up with the corporates.
Yes, sir.
Take for example, my mechanical admissions were very poor.
Mm-hmm.
I tied up with Siemens.
Mm-hmm.
Siemens said, we manufacture the machines, but we supply the machines. Those corporates who buy my machines, they are not able to operate.
Yeah.
So I want to come to your campus and train the students how to operate these machines in your mechanical engineering.
That is what we do in Gibbs also, sir, that we are coming out with the finishing school where we connect our students. It's not about the subject or the material which we teach. We teach them their life skills. As you rightly said in your last talk, that skill set.
Dr. Aparna, that also requires an investment from educational institutions also on faculty members.
Yes, sir.
Can't expect members to part their
salary. No, sir. This is the I strongly feel like this is the investment which we have to do. Maybe if you take, as you rightly said, that the corporate, it is rightly the investment, maybe in the amount of whatever the skill sets we do, the student is expecting this only, not the material which we are getting it. As
my last statement.
Yes, sir.
Recently, I met one of the vice chancellor. I asked him, why you resigned from vice chancellor position? He asked me a question, are you enjoying? I had no answer for that.
Sir, maybe for me, I'm enjoying my finishing school. And I think Supriya should also nod that yes, we are enjoying. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. All your blessings into it.
I want to add a point on this. Definitely, it's not just about the subjects we have been taught. It's definitely more than that, the corporate need. What is that? We have been taught on that, like IRE school, campus to corporate. We are able to connect with the corporate world. Like, I would like to add on that point.
Thank you, Supriya. Thank you, sir. It's such an insight which you have given, Dr. Kumar. It's really an eye-opening for any educationist and also the colleges who's running the things. Yes, sir. Datta, sir, you want to say something on this?
I wanted to just, 30 seconds I'll take. What the requirement of the day is for the executives is, and what Dr. Kumar has very rightly brought out. And, every word had so much of depth. The definition and the redefining engineering of executives have to change. And what Mr. Singh had also brought out, that the hybrid skilling or upskilling that is required. So what you require is today's executive, he should walk briskly, he should talk briefly, he should think on feet, and act on facts, and deal with tact. So that is the kind
of... That's wonderful, sir. That's really wonderful.
What we require.
I think we are making all this and putting into one ball and giving it to our students. Yeah. Sir, it's really wonderful to have this answer from both of you, sir.
Yeah.
I would move on. It is interesting to look back at e-commerce growth. That's what Mr. Singh was talking about. So the growth over the last few years, and think forward to the future of this industry, overall percentage of e-commerce retail sales have substantial growth in last few months. Now, Mr. Singh, in this regard, as we have already, you already quoted over it here, a small interesting question which I had now. What can be the new marketing strategies to convince the consumers to buy the products, especially on the post-pandemic? And I personally feel as there may be a downfall in buying power. So maybe I'm contradicting Mr. Kausagi here. He said the saving part is more, but whatever. The buying power as a normal female or as a normal mother, I feel my buying power maybe in the pandemic has gone down, as you people rightly said, that maybe the health, the care and all that increase. So how do you say, sir? What is your views into it?
Yeah, so in terms of designing marketing strategies post-pandemic, or you can call these as new generation marketing strategies, I teach my students three things. When I did my engineering in 83, I did my MBA 83, 85, we were taught customer fulfillment. You make a promise to customer and you fulfill it. But in today, if I have to, I'm teaching students, that is just one element, customer fulfillment. Today, I sign a contract with my customer. 3 days later, customer says my needs have changed.
Yes.
Okay. Even Amazon, Flipkart, they give you an option, changed your mind, change
the order. It's changed the product.
Even not changing. You place the order in the morning, in the evening, you are changing the, I don't want this blue color cover for my laptop. I want red color. Okay.
Truly speaking, I do a lot, sir.
So the number two is changing needs, fulfillment of needs, changed needs and their fulfillment. And the third most important thing is connected experiences. I give a very small example and then I'll stop. I think we are at the top of the hour. In fact, a few minutes more than that. You go to a restaurant, you place an order, they will fulfill, that will be customer fulfillment. 10 minutes later, you say, no, make it less spicy. I didn't tell you. They say, okay, no, don't worry, we'll make it less spicy. So the number two thing, customer fulfillment, change of needs. And you sat at a place where the dish was very tasty, but you sat at a place where the air conditioning was poor. You come home, you say awful experience. Your need was customer fulfillment happened, change in the need happened, experience was poor. So marketing strategy, all students, I think we have around 300 students listening, participating. Three things always keep in mind. Fulfill the promise. If customer asks for a change, fulfill that change and provide a top-in class, delightful connected experience. If I place an order on Amazon, evening I changed my choice of color, that is has been taken into consideration. 2 days later, I get my, instead of blue color, I get my red color. everything fine, same price. These are the digital interfaces.
Yes.
Customer fulfillment, change of needs fulfillment, top in class experience. This is the marketing strategy we have to teach our students for future.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. It was, I know it's an every normal consumer like me also got connected everywhere into whatever you spoke now. Sir, I'll take this question to Mr. Kausgi. Sir, it is a bit of connection with this. How did consumers and corporate manage stress during COVID?
Okay, I think before I take on this question, Dr. Aparna, let me try to connect the dots. Purchasing power has increased. If you see last 1 year, what has happened? Spend on traveling. Spend on purchasing luxury items. That's at the bottom.
Yeah.
Holidaying has completely come to a halt. There are no business travels. There is no purchase of luxury items because there was a lot of anxiety amongst consumers post-pandemic and during pandemic, how the future will pan out. And therefore, it is a forced savings. And therefore, if we look at data, this is data, right? And therefore, savings is gone. So increased savings will propel increase in purchasing power. I think that's the missing line which I wanted to connect before I take on this question. And as Brigadier Datta said, you must have been in cricket. You must have been a cricketer. This again is a good way to me. Okay, let me try to answer to best of my knowledge. So definitely during pandemic, every single person, every single entity, irrespective of how small or how big, you know, were worried. Either because of the life threat, because of pandemic, or because of the financial position. These two are the only things. There's no third thing to worry about during pandemic. Either there's no food to eat, or you need to ensure that you survive during this pandemic time so that, you know, if you survive, I used to generally tell people you survive for next 30 days, 45 days, then you can live next 30 years happily. You know, assuming that there's no third wave and no other pandemic hits. So definitely there was stress for every single consumer and every single entity, including government of India, whether it is state government, regulators, or whoever it is, right? Now, it is more of a necessity to manage. So when someone is pushed to a corner, you know, we think of innovative things. We'll figure out ways how to survive. Now, I think best in class example is that, you know, how the corporate, I'll talk about corporate because I'm from that background.
Yeah.
We've seen that most of the way corporate India has come back after the pandemic last year, especially in quarter three and quarter four. In quarter four, we thought that, you know, there was nothing like, you know, Corona, which happened a few months back. I think mm-hmm. that extent, basically it's pent up demand. So during this phase, it's very, very tough phase. We need to survive. We need to ensure that we take care of our health well. And also health of the company. When I say health of the company, it could be a small enterprise, it could be a small kirana shop owner, it could be a small enterprise, maybe a mid-sized corporate, maybe a large corporate. When I say health, be high on liquidity. Ensure that you survive. Ensure that, you know, you are in excess to survive for next 6 to 8 months time. And once you survive this pandemic for next few months, and then if need be, you can rebuild. And therefore, it's very important, you know, that we adapt. And that is what we've seen this. Definitely, there was stress. And we've seen that, you know, after wave one, and of course, now wave two is almost coming to an end. In wave two, we see a lot of confidence amongst consumers because it's almost coming to an end. So if you look at going forward, the first thing what has to be done is that they have to stay afloat. They have to first survive, at least for next year or two. Once they do that, they need to raise funds if they have to be afloat. There should always be excess in cash, which means high on liquidity. And then it's very important because of this pandemic, there is a lot of shift towards digitization.
Yes, sir.
And to that extent, I think everyone, whether it is a small shop, big corporate, irrespective of the sector or the industry, I think one has to digitize, cut cost, innovate, and come out with new products. I'll give you a small example of all these pharma companies. Anyway, they were busy during the pandemic time, and there was a need for sanitizer. And you will not believe that industry at one point in time grew to about 30,000 crores, which used to be about less than 2,000 crores. And now probably with wave two, that would have, you know, even grown bigger. So in innovation, coming out with new products, adapting to the need of the market, and aligning with customer need, I think that's very, very important. So stress is part. When there is stress, I think there is a need to innovate, think differently, and try to survive and probably grow.
Yes, sir.
Pandemic. I think that is what we've seen in phase one. We are seeing that in phase two. See, phase two, all the corporates, every single individual has become a bit smarter because now they have experience. So now we can see the spends going up compared to COVID, you know, phase one, wave one, right? I think it's a process. I think we have to go with the process. This too shall pass. I think that's the...
That's a very interesting thing. That is what it too shall pass, sir. It's so positive to take that it too shall pass. Sir, like I'm exceeding the time. I ask everybody, I request everybody for 10 more minutes that we'll finish it a little bit fast. So, sir, to Dr. Kumar, I just wanted to ask a question here. What are your key suggestions you give for the businesses to sustain the post-pandemic?
Note of the time, I'll take only 1.5 minutes.
Please, sir.
I remember an African proverb. If you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. Has to be the mantra if you want to sustain in the business. Now, when I say that, let me articulate it with five mantras. One is value to the customer.
Yeah.
Second one is investment in employees. Third one is fair and ethical dealing with suppliers. And the fourth one is supporting surrounding communities. And fifth one, and not the last one, generating long-term value to the shareholders.
Yes. 100%.
If you address these five things, the statement with which I had started, that is, grow the pie, is possible.
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for that crisp answer. I know teachers always understand better. I go to the next question. No one knows how long this pandemic will last. True, no, sir. But it looks like this will change the way we work and the way organizations function going forward. To increase the agility and resilience, Mr. Singh, according to you, how prepared the world, to be precise, the organizations in the new digital era?
Yeah, so again, I'll just take a minute or so.
You're also a teacher, sir?
Yeah, so I would say that we will have a new construct of the organization. Now, what is that construct? Earlier, what was organization? This year, 100 people or 2,000 people working in this organization. You can have only one person working in the organization and 10,000 partners adding value to the economic chain of the company. We are moving toward that construct. Today, Flipkart, I mean, I was Dean of E-Commerce Academy for Flipkart for some time as a consultant, of course. There are 15,000 employees. And when I was there were 9,000 employees. But there are 250,000 partners digitally connected.
Yeah.
So today you can have 10 employees and 10,000 partners.
Yes.
And partners are also adding value. As Professor Kumar was saying, value creation. So value creation is not in the digital era, not only by employees, but extended enterprise.
Yeah.
That is number one. Number two, in terms of my office, my laptop is my office.
Yeah.
I can work from anywhere. I need a good connectivity. I need this thing. And we are going to see profound changes. If in the campus, industrial campus, there are 1,000, seats for which I have a real estate, Maybe I only now book 500. Everybody doesn't come every day. And there is a free seating. I mean, I was looking after Australian market also. So there we vacated few towers. And we said, wherever you get your seat, you go and sit. And you don't have to come every day to the office. Maybe 2 days in a week. Rest your laptop is your office. These are some of the, I mean, changes at workplaces, a new concept of the organization in digital era. And that is how we prepare for the future. Future is very different from today. And today was also future. If we look at 2015 to 2021 was a future.
Yes.
You would have thought the future.
In a different way of the world. That's it.
And to 2025 is going to be different.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Sir, if I don't ask this finance question, maybe the viewers would not have the complete picture. The country's financial system should also collaborate with the government to power a larger ecosystem that can extend credit and other services to the impoverished section of the society. Will a strong digital backbone effectively complement India's traditional banks? Mr. Kausiki, what's your ideas into it?
I'll keep it very short, Dr. Aparna, due to paucity of time. So
yes, sir.
What is need of the hour in our country is that we have to promote farm sector, more farm sector. That is number one. And number two, we have to promote micro enterprises. And we have to ensure that there is enough credit available. Today, why farm sector, in terms of availing credit and micro enterprise, they're not able to access required funds? It's only because of the awareness of repayment culture. I think we get the repayment culture in, you know, into shape. I think that's when you will see a lot of improvements happening. And there should be more allocation from government for these two sectors. A, B, government can go to a certain extent and try to, you know, support. I think beyond that, availability of finance from banks and financial institutions, for that repayment culture is important. I'll give you one more. You know, most of the times, you know, we think that if I give a debt waiver, it's going to help the consumer. Actually, it's not. Debt waiver will not help the customers, because customers, in anticipation of debt waiver, would stop paying, or that would derail the repayment, you know, culture. I think we need to build that culture and we need to promote these two. It could be SHGs, it could be JLGs, it could be MFIs. All these things comes under, you know, micro enterprise and small entrepreneurs, right? Now, whether digitization will, you know, take care of the issue what we have. See, today, digitization is more of a mindset. Today, if you see, you take any industry, if you take private and public, today, the difference is, you know, human capital, the quality of human capital. That's number one. And number two, obviously, if you have to hire good people, you have to pay well, which means today, if you look at pay structure between private and public, because this is a structural issue. This is an issue which has been lingering since many, many decades. There's a huge difference, and the difference could run into probably 50 times or more than 50 times if you look at any level. I think it's more of, you need to get the right skill set, you need to hire right people to do the right job, and also to inculcate that, you know, that culture, you have to get the pay scales at least close between, you know, public and private. Today, if you see the difference between private, you take any software company or you take a steel sector, which is into private and which is into public. If you compare the salary difference between private and public, it runs into 50 times, 60 times.
Yeah.
I think that is the reason why you see even, you know, differentiation in terms of performance.
Yes, sir.
Yes, to a certain extent now, because of the sheer presence of the public sector banks in most of the rural areas, it is supporting farm sector to a certain extent, may not be because of digitization, because even adoption is an issue. Even today, I think all the PSU banks, they've gone to a stage of internet banking and mobile banking.
Yes, sir.
There is something beyond that, something called as pre-qualified approval, pre-sanction, you know, without opening any branch, you can try it. I think there's a huge difference. I think this is something which probably has to come from top, has to come from government. I think it's a journey. I think we need to work on that. Then only you can see that, you know, both would complement each other.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you. I think the time is getting over, sir. I'll give a last question. Brigadier, sir, if I'm not asking you this, I cannot finish the complete show it. Are we ready to shift to war fighting mode? As you know, that present world, the decision making from decentralization, we have to come to the centralized decision part of it. Do we see such an attitude and structure in the organizations operating in India to learn from the crisis and adapt themselves for the changing environment? So in this particular environment, from this war fighting mode, my question I'm asking you is this: what do you suggest they equip with the face the crisis and to be more agile, sir?
Thank you, Dr. Aparna. That's a very, I think, valid question which we've asked. You know, if you're going through such a overwhelming crisis or overwhelming situation, yes, the nation has to work on war footing. And you see, like, you know, we have been talking about finishing schools. There is a tremendous amount of requirement, and it is imperative that we must have some finishing education to the leaders also. What the nation should learn from the defense forces is that, you see, there is no runners-up prize in the army. You can't say there was a war between India and Pakistan and we stood second. No. If there is a mission failure, the leader is eased off. He's held accountable. Like, yeah. When I, you know, left the bullets and joined the, you know, the corporate world, somebody asked me, he says, what is the difference between army and corporate? So I told him, in army, you see the enemy in front. And in corporate, I don't have to tell you. Because
enemies everywhere.
So what they have to do is that they should understand that, you know, there is no point doing rhetoric, and the national character of a country is read from the kind of debates. And you know, because I keep going on every second day on you know, TV panels.
Yeah, I know, sir.
So people have to differentiate between noise and news. People have to differentiate between substance and, you know, talking you know, something which is not befitting their status. So what they should do is that they should have the framework is there. The policies are there. The advisories are there. The authorities which are supposed to be enablers are the biggest impediments. Nothing happens to a person. If there is a mission failure in the army, the leader is taken to task. You see, and here it is adding feather to your cap.
Yeah.
People are, you know, there are different rules. Like, I'll give you another example. You know, I'll take 30 seconds, pardon if I'm, you know, boring people. We have been talking of this oxygen. You know, there was I was on a TV panel, and I told them, America, why can't you give it to these, you know, distribution to the defense forces? Why can't you, you know, and the Disaster Management Act, you know, amplifies it. It mandates it. But they will not do it because there are vested interests.
Yes.
They don't want, and they want to give it, and they gave it at the time when the nation was crying, when the nation was, in fact, the infrastructure had totally collapsed like a house of cards. Leave aside medical attention, a decent cremation was also not, you know, possible. I lost my father during that time.
Very sorry, sir.
Yeah, he has fought. You know, he has fought 1962 war with the Chinese, but he succumbed to the Chinese virus.
I know.
And, you know, it is a sad commentary. So the nation has to, the authorities, which are enablers, should exercise control. People should be taken to task. There should be work audit. You see, I'm also son of, you know, some parent, some mother. But why is that my, you know, formatting is done that way? You know, there are two options in crisis. One is the flight mode, one is the fight mode. Why does a soldier takes it to the fight mode and the some other people take it to the flight mode? Because he has been told that, yes, you have to work for naam, namak, nishan. You have to work for the country. You have to work. Jiska namak khaya hai, aap uski puri, aap last blood tak aap, you will look after that organization. Whether it is, whether you are a business leader, whether you are an education leader, whether you are a corporate leader or a military leader, I will sum it up with just one maxim. Today only there was a passing out parade in Indian Military Academy. People, you must have seen people passing out from the Chatwood building. And the motto is inscribed on the wall there. The safety, honor, and welfare of your country comes first, always and every time.
Yeah.
The people you command or the subordinates, their welfare, their security, their comfort comes next. Your own ease as an officer or as a leader, your own ease, your safety and comfort will always come last every time. So this is the credo for the officers. This is the principle for the officers. And if you apply this in any kind of leadership, whether it is business leadership, whether it is corporate leadership, whether it is education leadership, I am sure people are going to take you on shoulders what we do in the army.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Jai such Hind. such a powerful last statement, sir. This is what is expected from a military man. So it's almost more than an hour, and we have come to the end of this panel discussion. And I didn't even realize that we have spent almost 1.5 hours in this. And I feel, the thirst is even more. Yes, sir. Yes, Kumar, sir.
Aparna, just excuse me, I have to join another meeting.
Sure, sir. Pleasure, so sir. So pleasure to have you here, sir. Pleasure to have you here.
Thank you, sir. Nice listening to you.
Nice listening to you, sir.
Thank you.
Nice listening to you, sir.
Sir, this is what, we have come to an end, and with a powerful statement from the army man, we are very much thankful to all of you. Sir, the n number of the questions which is poured in into the question answer sessions, I could only give a couple of the questions to you people because of there is no time, lack of time, and I have taken your time also more. I'm so sorry for that, sir. Sir, there is a question which has been repeated with Mohadisa Rajan to Dr. Vinod, sir. Can you please repeat the point that you said, act on facts? So what is this act on facts which you have asked for? This is what is the question he asked two times. I think Mr. Rajan, sir, will be explaining you. Sir. Vinod, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Could you just repeat the question again?
Sir, he asked you, can you please repeat the point that you said, act on facts? I think maybe.
Yeah. You see, as a business executive, you should always act on the facts. There is no point, don't listen to the naysayers. Don't listen to the hearsay, ke usne aisa kaha hoga, or the figures, or whatever the WhatsApp university is feeding you. As a business executive or as a corporate leader, you should always reassertain. You must always reconcile your facts. I'll just give you an example. You must have heard about Nelson Mandela. He was son of a tribal chief. As a child, he used to always go with his father. And he will, accompany him. And his father will listen to the local, tribal chiefs. What he learned is that he would firstly listen to the all local tribal chief. Firstly, it gave him an opportunity to listen to them. Because half of the time, if you listen to a person, the 50% problems are solved. He will give them the attention which they deserve. In the meantime, he got the inputs from those tribal chiefs. And then he will, collate and condense that information. And then he gave out his verdict or whatever decisions he. So what Nelson Mandela learned from his father was that you must firstly listen. And that's why our human anatomy is also made like this. We got two ears and one tongue. So it is always better to, have more inputs and speak adequately. So it is better to act on facts rather than on naysayers or on facts or on conjecture or on hearsays.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Just to add, in corporate world, for example, a lot of times we react without verifying facts. Facts means data, because data doesn't lie. So if you look at data and analyze, I'm sure you'll be acting based on facts.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. This question, I would wanted to give it to Mr. Singh. Octavia Antonis Isamil is asking this question. Is it possible to start a new business during this pandemic situation?
Yeah, a lot of, India is, in fact, I answered 5-6.
Yes, sir.
India has a third largest startup ecosystem in the world. And a lot of these businesses today we have 21 unicorns. During pandemic, we would, and by next year, and the lot of time during pandemic, we are having 52 sunicorns. Sunicorns means the startup which will become unicorn. And unicorn is a business with 7,000-8,000 crores, $1 billion of market capitalization. So to answer this, there are multiple opportunities. Digital transformation of economy has given so many. And when I say digital, doesn't mean that you have to. I gave the example of 5 companies which are producing of the top 6 digital solutions for the entire world. And just 95% are consuming. So you can either produce a digital solution or you can consume a digital solution. So there are multiple, since the question is very open-ended,
yes,
definitely, lot many opportunities. Your students are welcome to connect with me.
Sure, sir. Pleasure.
I also have to leave because I have an engagement at 7. And I think it will take me at least 20-25 minutes to reach there. So if you
can sir.
Me also, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Great listening to you, sir. Thank you so much for giving this opportunity.
Giri, sir, one last question. He is asking this question again and again, Himanshu. Nursing back post-COVID financial system is a big challenge. Sir, what do you say this?
Yeah, definitely, yes. I think to that extent, the government has come forward, regulator has come forward. If you look at wave one, there was a moratorium offered to every single customer who wants to, which means, in simple words, moratorium means repayment holiday for 6 months. So 6 months, customer, irrespective of whether one is salaried or self-employed, non-professional or self-employed professional, every single individual who had loan, for example, would get 6 months repayment holiday. And immediately after that, there was a restructuring option, which means that there could be step up EMI. If the installment was, let's say, 20,000 rupees, and if the consumer is facing difficulty in paying so much, I think the institution can come forward and say, okay, you pay 30% of EMI for next few months. I think the overall cap was 2 years. So even in second wave, there is a restructuring option. And definitely because the stress is going to be there and the priorities would change during pandemic to that extent. Yes, government has come forward and there are so many schemes announced by government to ease difficulty to the consumers during this time. So it is difficult, but I think because of all these efforts, the difficulty has come down to a drastic extent. And if you look at this time, the pandemic curve is very short. COVID second
thank
wave
you.
Is very
yes,
short.
Sir. So thank you, sir.
Pain is going to be less. Thank
yes,
you.
Sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you. It was really a power-packed session we had for 1.5 hours. I have taken a lot of time, maybe half an hour more of your time. I'm so sorry for that, sir. I know that all of you are very busy, but the discussion itself has taken us. We have carried out with the discussion and we could not even see the watches. Thank you for this, sir. Before I go to the vote of thanks to Supriya, thanks for all the participants. Sir, I should tell you, we have 300 plus participants all over the globe. We have many international participants also. I thank all the participants, and I hope that all of you would have enjoyed this session with the four eminent people from different fields. So GIBS is, you know, we are doing a lot of webinars and a lot of programs digitally where we are connecting the students. It is for our students and also for everybody around. I just wanted, I'll just take a minute to the participants, especially the attendees will get the certificates on Monday on their registered email IDs. Kindly register for our upcoming events. We are having the blasting events, which is upcoming. National level webinar on mindset of an innovator on 17th June by Dr. Kaustubh Dagalkar. It is an power pack session by him, especially on the mindset of an innovator. How does it go? Please register for this. And quality improvement program, which is also, we call it to be the FTP, which is open for the faculty and for students and to the corporates. This is by Dr. Alok Kumar from IIM Vizag, and also by Dr. Sachin Mangala from University of Plymouth, UK on 27th June. It's a full day program, before lunch and after lunch program. And we are coming out with one of the best HR conclaves. That is, the topic is on future of work, HR. The catalyst is the catalyst in the association with L&D Global. So this is one of the global unit which is coming out onto the thing with association with them. JIBS is coming out with this HR conclave, which is coming on 10th July, that is maybe after a month, 10th July 2021. Please, all of you, register yourself and attend this programs. That would be a great learning for all of you. So this is what is upcoming programs in GIBS, sir. It's my pleasure to have you here. Sir, we need this association further. We want you to come to GIBS and please share your knowledge. Please share your ideas. It will help our students and it will help the student fraternity in total. Thank you, sir. And Supriya, what is your takeaway, ma? What is that? What did you really enjoyed it?
Definitely, I would thank GIBS giving this opportunity to host an esteemed panel, I should say. And a big salute to Vinod, sir. I have really realized a lot from what defense ministries go ahead and what we need to incorporate for our corporate well-being. And it's really, really a great session. I have heard a lot more times earlier in my first trimester and second trimester. I hope to hear again and again. And I could relate a lot concepts from you. And I could, I don't have words about this, what I can express. It's really honored and humbled to host you on this day, to have as a panelist today. And the insights what you have given, especially on what we need to learn from defense to the corporate, what we can take. Thank you so much, sir. And I would thank Girish, sir, for giving such a valuable insights about financial statistics, what our economy is undergoing and how can we develop from that and how can we downturn the crisis and get forward, and what are the opportunities for entrepreneur in the financial aspect for the statistics what you have given. Thank you so much, sir, for being a panel for the day. And I would also like to thank our panelists like DNS Kumar, sir. Unfortunately, he had another event to attend. But the five mantras what sir have given, I think we can inculcate in our marketing strategies going ahead. It can be being an entrepreneur or a corporate. I think that we need to inculcate that, have already penetrated into our minds being a student. And I would also like to thank Antapreet Singh, sir, has given marketing 4.0, a digital look, I could say, painted with the digital ideas. That is really, really a glad insight what we have taken, the intuition what we have got. And I would like to thank our moderator for the day, Aparna ma'am. The series of questions you have tailored for the panelists shows the acumen of eloquence what you have put into, the deep diligence I could see on that. Thank you so much, ma'am. That was really insightful. And last but not least, I would like to thank all the participants for their eminent participation. And as a student of GIBS, I could say that we have inculcated these kind of discussions a lot more from the first trimester, so which is helping us to driven towards the second. It's not about placement, not about, but learning a lot of skills. So I would recommend all of you to take insight on our website and all about links and the panel discussions and webinars, which are pipelined ahead. Please join us and get a lot of information from that. And thank you so much for giving this opportunity.
Thank you, Supriya. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.